Thank you, Holy Spirit.
We can give you some volume now.
We have been considering the cycle of the Christian experience, the journey of man from within God back to God. The idea was not for man to depart from God at any time. The idea was for the man to remain fused in God and to carry out the function of kingdom advancement and the function of dominion on the face of the earth in partnership with God. The mystery of dominion is the mystery of Mahanaim, where the armies of heaven and the armies of earth becomes one. And so the realities of heaven are downloaded into earth. And by so doing, the dominion that exists in the third heaven will begin to find expression in the visible realm. It's called the mystery of Mahanaim. When Jacob was returning from the house of Laban in Genesis 32 verse 2, that was when Jacob revealed to us what made it possible for him to be dwarfed, even though his enemies were trying to frustrate him and to ridicule his life. There was something about Jacob, and there was something Jacob knew that conferred perpetual dominion upon his life. It's called the reality of Mahanaim. And so when he was journeying back, he saw the angels of the Lord marching from heaven, and he aligned with them. And so the front of the heavens and the front of the earth becomes one. That is how dominion is exercised on the face of the earth. That man fuses into God to a point where you can't tell whether it is man or it is God at work. If you attack the man, you attack God. So what happens in heaven begins to happen where that man is. And so Paul said, I labor more than them all, yet not I, but the grace of God that is in me. So you can't tell when it is Paul's effort, and you can't tell when it is the effort of God. There is so much oneness that the spirit and the man becomes one. Jesus, walking on the face of the earth, said, the Son of Man, which is in heaven, it is a reality called man. That man and God become one. So heaven and earth also becomes one. So the things of heaven can become the things of earth. That was how Eden was created. Eden was not necessarily a product of agricultural intelligence. What happened was that God downloaded what was in heaven to earth. Because before the earthly Eden was created, the Bible revealed to us in Ezekiel 28 from verse 17 that there is another Eden in Zion. So what God did was that he downloaded the Eden of heaven to earth. And that was why God could appear in Eden. He could walk into Eden and walk out. There was no door, because Eden was an extension of heaven to earth. It's a mystery of Mahanaim. So when God created the man, God wanted the man to function from within him. And by so doing, he would dominate the earth realm. But the man was deceived by the serpent, and he decided to take a journey of rebellion, a departure from the walk of intimacy. The moment that happened, the man became dead, bereft of glory, and there was nothing good found in him. So the man needed a savior in order to be restored back to God. And so Jesus came from heaven, because you have to come from heaven to take earth to heaven. So Jesus came from heaven and restored the man back to an ascended reality. And we said, for us to constantly walk in that reality, we must stay yielded to the Holy Spirit. Because the Holy Spirit is the bridge between the heavens and the earth. That is the cycle of the human experience. That the man who once upon a time was departed from God has now returned to the Lord. And because he has returned to the Lord through the ministry of the Holy Spirit, he can bring the dimensions of Zion to his visible realm. He's no longer running into the world to try to survive. He's rather coming into the world from the heavenly dimension so that he can dominate the natural realm. This is what we have been trying to say in the last 2 days. And tonight, because of the significant and all-important place of the Holy Spirit, because of the significance of the ministry of the Holy Spirit. First of all, in keeping you fused to God, and secondly, in empowering you to dominate your world, we need to understand how to stay yielded to the Holy Spirit. If it takes the Holy Spirit for you to remain connected to God, and if it takes the Holy Spirit for you to be able to exercise dominion in your world, then you need to understand how you need to stay connected and yielded to this Holy Spirit. Because as it stands now, the most significant equation in your life is the connection between you and the Holy Spirit. Because in that connection, you are fused to God. And in that connection, you dominate your world. So, what are the step-by-step procedures of staying connected with the Holy Spirit? That's what I want to share tonight. I tried to do a recap in the morning and we got lost. So I will not do any further recap. I will just go to the point, and because I'm racing against time, I will be picking the point one after the other so we can move. We may not be able to delve deep into it, but we'll just touch it so that you will know it. And even a baby can understand it. The first way to remain yielded to the Holy Spirit is to become sensitive to the promptings of the Spirit. To become discerning of the promptings of the Spirit. We call it the move and the movements of the Holy Spirit in the soul of a man. Before the man accepted Jesus, he did not have that vital connection to the Holy Spirit, and he could not intrinsically discern the moves of the Spirit. But now that the Holy Ghost has come to live on his inside, it is possible for everyone who has the Holy Spirit to become discerning of the Holy Spirit. So if you want to stay yielded to the Holy Spirit, the first way to begin this journey is to be sensitive to the moves of the Spirit. And then you ask yourself, how am I going to know this? You will know it because it's an organic economy. When you receive the Holy Spirit, you become one with the Holy Spirit. The Bible says, him that is joined with the Spirit is one with him. So if you have truly received Jesus Christ, you are one with the Holy Spirit. Before now, it was impossible. But when the Holy Ghost came, he did not only tabernacle on your inside, but he introduced a law to your spirit man. That law that he introduced to your spirit man will naturally begin to regulate it. In Romans chapter 8 verse 2, it said, the law of the Spirit of life that is in Christ Jesus have set me free from the law of sin and death. The same way you didn't know how you understood the language of demons, that's how you do not know how you understand the promptings of the Spirit, because these are organic. Before the Holy Ghost came, you could pick the movement of demons. For 1 month, on the 14th day, the lady will begin to bring the message and reply. On the 20th day, the lady will go out with you. On the 30th day, the lady will come to visit you in your house. Because there is a power in death that also mastered everyone that is falling. The same way as the Holy Ghost came into your life, he introduced a law that will master you. The word set me free in Romans 8:2 is the word eletero. And what that law, that word means is that the Holy Ghost has enlivened your soul. The Holy Ghost has activated your soul. The Holy Ghost has empowered your soul. So you cannot pick the frequencies of heaven. It is not
to a point where you can quickly move the spirit. That's why I said, my sheep hear my voice and they obey, they follow me. It is not something you learn. It is intrinsic and it is organic because of the law of life that is at work in you. There is no man that has the Holy Spirit that doesn't know the moves of the Spirit, that doesn't understand the moves of the Spirit. It's not a function of a mighty apostle. It's a reality for every believer that has the Holy Ghost on his inside. And as you begin to respond to that prompting, the Holy Ghost now enters step two. What it does in step two is in Romans 8:11. In the same spirit that raised up Jesus from the dead lives in your mortal body, he will mortify. He will mortify your mortal body and he will quicken the organic reality of God on your inside. So the Holy Ghost begins to reduce the deadness of your body. He begins to reduce the inactivity, spiritual inactivity of your senses, and it begins to quicken the God dimension on your inside. So your duty now is to always stay sensitive. So every time you discern that quickening, what you do is that you respond to it. The more you begin to respond to it, the more that law begins to master you. The law begins to master you. That's how you grow in yielding to the Holy Spirit. Let me show you something about Paul quickly, so that you know how Paul lived his life. There is a realm superior to word of knowledge. There is a realm superior to discerning of spirits. The prophets of old did not have God living on their inside, but they functioned in word of knowledge. They functioned in discerning of spirits. Ezekiel saw the throne of God. Moses saw the throne of God. Most of them saw spirits. They interacted with angels. They had words of knowledge for individuals and for nations. People like Elijah could tell you what is happening in your bedroom. Without the Holy Spirit, God just came upon them and lifted and they picked a lot of things. But there is a realm that is superior to just knowing things. It's a realm where you become one with God. So as God moves, you move. As God moves, you move. That is the realm of the new creation. It is a realm. That's why, see, at your level now, every word of knowledge you receive should confirm what is already happening on your inside. We are no longer directed by words of knowledge. Words of knowledge come to reassure and to confirm us, because what the Holy Ghost is telling somebody to tell you is what is already doing as an activity in your soul. But the problem is that many have not discerned it. That's why in the New Testament, prophets are also teachers. They are not like the Old Testament prophet that just came to give direction. In the New Testament, every accurate prophet you see is a teacher. Because his goal is not to have you dependent on him. His goal is to make you to understand the moves of the Spirit on your inside. Take a look at the life of Paul. Let me share a few scriptures with you so you see how we live in the New Testament. We live in the New Testament by yielding to the Holy Spirit. Most of the things these guys did, they were just movements. They were movements. The guy comes to a place and he wants to speak, and God says, no, today you are not a teacher. Today you are a servant, so sing. And then he came with a whole lecture note that he wanted to teach. And as he begins to sing, the Holy Ghost himself begins to teach the people. He's 1,000 times stronger functioning like that. And the apostles of old knew this. In Acts chapter 13, verse 9, Paul was speaking to a high politician, very senior officer in a city. And then here was a sorcerer trying to turn away the mind of that politician. Hope you know, every politician, naturally, those who are not born again, they have sorcerers around them that give them counsel. Because in the olden days, a wise man is not a man full of knowledge. In the olden days, a wise man is a man who can look into the spirit and isolate the counsel of the spirit. So if you cannot commune with the spirit, you are not wise. Because wisdom in those days is not a function of reading textbooks. Everybody read. But it takes only wise men to navigate through the spirit. And when they tell you tomorrow, don't go out, it will rain. That one, you don't read it in the textbook. You're picking from the heart of the spirit. So kings work with wise men. If they want to go to war, all of them know the strategies of war, but the wise man will come and say, this battle will go if you go, you will die. And even though the king, his army is 3 times the army of his opponent, he will stop the battle, he will go for peace. Such were the wise men that walked with great kings. And Paul was talking to a king. And then one of these wise men came and was darkening the counsel that Paul was bringing. And Paul didn't do anything until a point came. The Bible says in Acts 39 that Paul, full of the Spirit. You see that? The word is the move of the Spirit. He sensed the move of the Spirit. And instantly he looked at him. He said, "You son of devil, of the devil. The hand of God is upon you. You will be blind for a season." The moment he said it, the Spirit that moved went to work. Because the utterance of Paul was the gateway for the Spirit into earth to carry out the assignment he wanted to carry out. So this is how these guys move. When the Spirit moves, they respond immediately because they have understood the movement of the Spirit. This is why they were powerful. They were not powerful because they knew a lot. They were not powerful because they have so many secrets here and there. One of the things that every one of them carried was that they were flexible with the Holy Ghost. You come to a point where you want to trade and the Holy Ghost restricts and you pick that movement. Even though the business looks so lucrative, you sense a movement that restricts you. And then you tell the person, "I'm sorry, I won't do this business." The person looks at you and like, "Are you okay?" I mean, this is the jackpot. But you say you won't. And suddenly, the next day, every equation was correct. But they tell you the business failed. And then you will thank your God that you have mastered the movement of the Spirit. What makes a believer invincible is not because he hides in the dark. What makes a believer invincible is because every time the Spirit moves, he knows the will of God. And he stands where God stands. But it takes your ability to discern the move of the Spirit. Many people are careless towards the move of the Spirit. They wake up in the morning, they sense that they should fast. But carry that day, they felt so hungry. And they wanted to eat. They carried the food to eat, they lose their peace. But they say, "Guy, maybe tomorrow." The Holy Ghost is not moving in that direction tomorrow. Tomorrow the Holy Ghost may want you to eat, but today he says fast. So that your fasting that you are doing tomorrow is religion. That one tomorrow is either religion or it is exercise, spiritual exercise. It will profit you, but it will not take you to where the Holy Ghost is. That's why some people come, they tell you they are fasting. That's why they connected to the Holy Ghost perpetually and they stayed yielded to the Spirit of God. In Acts 13, verse 46, Paul and Barnabas came to Jerusalem to preach and everybody was against them. Naturally, we hide because those days they will kill you. They will stone you to death. They were that religious. But suddenly, the Bible says, Paul and Barnabas waxed bold in the Spirit. You know, in our day and time, when a man of God comes, they receive him at the airport with flowers. And then they drive him in a jeep to a hotel. And then they set the altar. He comes to the altar and preach on soup. In the days of old, it's not like that. You can come to a city, you want to preach, and they say, "We don't have rain here for the past 6 months." So if that of God, they don't know the movements of the Spirit. A Paul is not quick to accept human validation. He's waiting to hear what the Holy Ghost will say first. And if the Holy Ghost validates him, even if everybody is against him, it doesn't matter. If the Holy Ghost validates him, it doesn't matter what you think. That is where God is, and he will stand there. He was grieved. How can you be praising a man and he's grieved? That means he's not functioning by his senses. It's the move of the Spirit. It's the move. There are many places they will invite you to. The honorarium will be 10 million kwacha. But when you go to pray, the movement of the Spirit will be against it. And he will respectfully tell the person, "I'm sorry, sir, I can't make it." The person can go about and say, "You are proud, you are arrogant." That's not your business. You were following the moves of the Spirit. That's how you will become invincible in this realm. In Acts 17, 16, Paul entered the city, a very religious city. Naturally, you say, "My God, there is revival in this land." The Bible says, while Paul sat down, he said he was stirred in the Spirit and he went out on evangelism. So Paul doesn't just go out to preach everywhere because he wants to be popular. It's not an ambition. It's a stirring. It's a stirring. Paul
tired, but he's there. And then he will stand up. Paul can come from a meeting, he's tired. Naturally, he shouldn't be able to pray. But when he goes to lie on his bed, that staring will come. And every time that staring comes, as he lifts
his hand and says, Father, I thank you. And then we go to work. And then the man who came tired suddenly becomes strong like a rock. And he will pray till morning. And then look at him to see, oh boy, you're strong. He's not strong. Don't worry. That's ATP. Come back after 6 hours. That's why you know the people that mount up. The ones that function by ATP after 2 hours from. They will now throw to their friends and say, Kai, oh boy, don't be sporting. Don't be sporting. Yeah. The guy is praying. If a pig falls, they will return. He's looking for everything to distract himself. He will go outside the auditorium after a while. He'll go and shake somebody and say, we are praying. He will go and make a call. He will go out and make a phone call and say, oh boy, the prayer is intense now. We are on the 4th hour. No, you are not on the 4th hour. You are on a phone call. Prayer is going on. After 1 hour, the person will remove his phone and say, this is the 4th hour of the 12-hour stretch. The guy who is praying is the one on the internet. After 3 hours, we are on the 3rd hour now. God is helping us. No, ATP has finished. He's looking for distraction. But the men that mount up, when it's going longer, that's when the general begins to walk. So when they started the prayer, he just... You think he's weak? No, he's not weak. He knows how this thing works. What he's doing? He knows. See, what he's doing, he's waiting for his wings. There is a support system that he needs to ascend. So he's there. Sometimes he prays in tongues, it doesn't work. The move has not started. He starts worshiping. You are the mighty God, the great I am. Hallelujah, hallelujah, you are the mighty God. He's not singing. What he's doing is that he's looking for ventilation. He's looking for ventilation. And as he's doing it, after a while, something will open in the spirit. Mataka, veriatatake, morula kainata, evuvevata, omeka, orurudagata. And sometimes, that guy can go and kneel down by the wall. And he's there, Nini Nanaka, Didida, Aradada. He will be there for 4 hours. 4 hours. After 4 hours, he will stand up. And then the guy that was interceding, when he stands up, he's no longer an intercessor. When he stands up, he becomes a warrior. Because what he was doing there, he was wearing his mantle. You think he was praying, he was wearing. And then after 4 hours, he stands up. Mato Kapaka, Deliatano. That's how we bring legislation. That's how we bring government. But it begins from discernment. But let me tell you, see, in spiritual things, your physical energy is not an advantage. It's a limitation. You will find it. Sometimes people are praying loud. You know that move is quiet. So you now discover that everybody there is a baby. They are impressing themselves with loud prayer. Hello, Evanaiko, Pakobo Kobaka. And you came, but you checked that no, the move of the spirit is quiet. So what you do is that you will lead them with their jamboree. And then you'll find a quiet place because you know what is happening. And then you'll keep there. You know, sometimes you'll come there because you came heavy and you need to be light for 1 hour. You say, Lord, have mercy, have mercy, have mercy, have mercy. Have mercy. You are trying to woo that spirit. You know, because before you came, there were certain things you needed to do, you didn't do. So you are wooing the Holy Ghost. Have mercy. Have mercy. Have mercy. When you make him feel like a king, then he will step out in glory. And then you hear, come up, Peter.
then suddenly you are sent.
It's a function of discernment.
When you find men that are on fire all the time, they are masters of the movements of the Spirit. They can discern the Holy Ghost. If the Holy Ghost is in a loud voice, they know. If it's in a quiet, still, small voice, they know. If it's in the fire, they know. Their job is not activity. They are looking for the movements of the waters. For the waters. When you have begun to master discerning the moves of the Spirit, then you activate the second. It's called quick obedience. Please sit down. I'm teaching you how to walk in the Spirit. It's not magic. It can be taught. The first one is discernment. The second is quick obedience. When the Holy Ghost moves, don't wait till we leave you behind. For 40 years, Moses was moving by following the direction of the pillar of fire to the pillar of cloud. When that thing stops, they stop. When it starts moving, even if it's 12 midnight, even if it's 1 a.m., even if it's 3 a.m., everybody, wake up! The pillar of fire has gone ahead. They don't walk with time. They walk with that movement. If it moves around 3 a.m., and you are still sleeping, when you wake up in the morning, the pillar is gone. You will wait again. If it passes that path, that's when you will find it. Obedience must be quick and complete for you to stay yielded. That's why when the Holy Ghost tells you, that's the easiest time to obey. If you wait for 1 hour, you may never obey again. Because that time when it tells you, the help of God is there. Because it will function by you as Ebenezer. But if you wait and it moves, and you think you will do it later by your own ability, you will fail. So every time the Holy Ghost begins to move, the secret is quick obedience. You have to, the moment you can discern, if you have not discerned it yet, take your time. But the moment you have discerned, it's the Holy Spirit. Even if your best friend is waiting, leave him there quickly. If you wait with him, both of you will be destroyed. But if you leave him, tomorrow you can deliver him. I remember many years ago, when we started obeying the Holy Spirit, he led some of us to a cave. And some of our friends were doing well. One went to Dubai. Then he will come and snap and put on Facebook. Behind the skyscraper, you will see 60 stories. Some of the building is only glass. And some of the building has strange shape. A building will be like this. Then he will stand there. Not the same. That was a departure from heaven. But building is the Lord is helping us. God of mercy. At that time, life became so tight. The Holy Ghost was teaching us how to master obedience. It is those journeys of obedience that have made us know how to walk through the fire and not be burned. How to walk through the water and not be drowned. Because when many people went the easy way, we followed the Holy Spirit in obedience. It was difficult, but it was a school of the Spirit. That's why David said, my God has taught my fingers to fight and my hands to war. He said, by God, I ran through a troop. One man can't run through a troop, but it is by God. When God was teaching him, it was in the cave of Adullam. He left Cave Adullam. He went to Cave Gilgal. He left Gilgal. There was a time he was walking the streets of Ashkelon like a madman. But God was teaching him the ways of obedience. That's when the man is fortified with strength. But many people, they defy obedience. Because when the movement came, that was when they were in their comfort zone. What you call a natural comfort zone is a grave of spiritual experience. If you don't wake up, it will swallow you up and it will eat up your season. When you think you are ready, that's when you have failed. The time you are ready is when the Holy Ghost moves. Because when he moves, he will make you to forego your natural advantage. And that's when we will learn that there is an advantage in the Spirit that is not mortal.
That's when you will learn there is an edge you have in the spirit that is beyond everything in the realm of mortality. Because most times when the Holy Ghost moves, that is the time when you are always compelled to give up what you call an advantage. He's teaching you how to walk in the spirit. He's teaching you how to walk on the waters and not be drowned. He's teaching you how to walk in the dark and still be illuminated, not by the light of the sun, but by the Shekinah of glory. Quick obedience. In Hebrews chapter 11, verse 7, the Bible says, Noah, being warned of God, he moved with fear. The moment God spoke, the man took off trembling. God speaks, you are still crossing your leg and say, I will do it tomorrow. You have missed it. You have missed it. You need to quickly begin to cry and repent. The reason many people are not succeeding in business today is because when God moved, they waited. And they have waited their season and passed. So the men that God positioned in strategic places to help them, other people have passed, those men have helped them. The reason many people are not succeeding in ministry is because when God said move, they waited. They wanted to do something first. And when they were doing something first, the help that God put around them. Some people have taken those help because the spirit realm is configured into times and into seasons. God speaks. Joseph was sleeping. An angel of the Lord came, tapped him. Matthew 2:13. Move now, take the child, and get down to Egypt. They would have killed Jesus. Because Jesus can't be killed. Take him now and get down to Egypt. That night, he stood up, woke Mary, let's move. That's a spiritual man. That night, he said, I will tell you when to return. He didn't wait till morning. Most of you, the journeys you should make it in the night, you delayed it for morning. That's why in the morning you are struggling. The Holy Ghost comes at night. He wants to teach you how to move like the eagle. He wants to teach you how to soar in the spirit. But that time you say, Lord, wait, let me wake up first. I was walking all night. I need to wake up. Ah! When you now wake up, the eagles have gone. And then you are running on barefoot. That's why I say I have seen an abomination on the face of the earth. That princes are walking in foot, while beggars are riding on horses. Because you didn't know your moment. When you discern, then you obey. There's a business God is telling you, start now. You say, no, God, this thing I'm doing now, if I leave it, there will be a problem. I'm earning a salary of 100,000. If I start this business, then you will know more. God says, start now. Did you know, he said, your sons and your daughters will come from afar. Strangers will stand to build your walls. He won't make your destiny by salary. What you want to do is bigger than your salary. Meanwhile, I'm not telling you to run and forego processes. I'm only telling you when you are sure it is God, then respond immediately. The only time you are permitted to wait is when you are not yet sure. But if you have discerned his voice, that's the time to move. You may start just with 100 quarters. He said now. That now is now. The time you will save 1 million quarters, that may not be the time. A man came to the city of Abuja with 100 million and he wanted to start ministry. He said, that's how ministry works in Abuja. There are big men in Abuja, so he must start to pack it in excellent. And then he rented an excellent hall. Bought chairs, bought LED screens, bought microphones. If you say, everybody will hear. If he's holding the mic and he moves it like this, you hear the sound of air. He could pick everything. Coordinated himself with robes and suits. They did the ministry for 6 months, of them million finished. But I know of Dr. Paul Energy. That came to Abuja and started from under the bridge looking for a house. And started with one room apartment with his wife. And today they have built 100,000 seat auditorium. Because your help is in the spirit. Quick obedience. That's the second way. Please sit down. That's the second way to stay yielded to the Holy Spirit. First is to discern the promptings. And second is to what? To respond in obedience. Number three is continuous engagement. When the Holy Ghost whispers to you today, wake up
by 5 a.m. to pray. Don't wait for him to come tomorrow. What he has told you is that there is something about your destiny that is locked in 5 a.m.
So if he says it once, follow it and begin to build on it. If the Holy Ghost comes today and say, join yourself to this assembly, don't wait for him to say it tomorrow. Stay there and do your best. If he says, begin to read about politics, don't wait for him to come tomorrow and say, read about the politics of Zambia. Read, no, begin to gather everything that has to do with it and start reading. Read until he tells you the next thing. So obedience is not momentary, it's continuous. So when God speaks and you obey, the first time you obey, you are going to discover there is a grace supplied. But after a while, it will look as if it's becoming difficult. What it means is that God wants you to grow. So if God tells you, pray by 12, you will stand up that night and you will cry in the morning. It will be like 10 minutes. Tomorrow, if you wake up by 12, you will pray, pray, pray. When you think you are praying, you will change your time to be 15 minutes. The first time you obey, you were gliding on the strength of that grace. The second time, God wants you to engage and grow. He's teaching you how to use the handles of the Spirit. It will be easy the first time you obey, but the next time, he wants you to constantly do it by faith. So you will wake up by 12, you will pray, pray, pray. When you pray out your life, it will be 30 minutes. You will be tired. You will go and put your leg in water. When you finish all your praying, it will be 1 year. You will stand up and begin to walk in your room. You will do it the next day when it's 12. Kai, if you wake up, you say, Jesus. You will sleep for 5 minutes. And then you will think you slept for 5 minutes, so I check your time. It's 4 a.m. Jesus, what happened? Since you still woke up, still stand up. The fourth day, you say, Kai, yesterday I woke up by 2 by 4. It will not happen today again. You now set alarm. The next time you open your eye, it is the sun from your cottage. It's 5:30 a.m. Don't stop. Marakobata. Tatalia, Melegado, Bakata, you pray. When you continue and you don't stop, what you are doing is that the law of life is not yet sensitive, but there is another law you are activating. It's called the law of consistency. When you begin to engage the law of consistency, there are spirits that mount that gate. When you do it for a while, what you are doing is that you are knocking on their door. You are knocking on their door. And after 2 weeks, after 3 weeks, those spirits will know that there is a voice that troubles us around 12. So when it is 12, after 3 weeks before you stand up, the spirit will be waiting for you. And as you stand up to pray, yesterday, which was the 21st day, you still struggled. But on the 22nd day, as you wanted to pray, Marakida, the next thing, the vision now opens. What is this? It's like a screen. Spirituality will become fun. It is a struggle because you have not followed the cadres. You will begin from discernment into obedience into continuous engagement. That's why I tell people, every area of grace you notice in your life, build a culture around it. There is a time when God will baptize you with fire and every night you will be praying. What it means is that there is a gate for you in the night. So don't wait for that fire. Build a culture around it. No matter how tired you are, even if it's 30 minutes, stand up that night and make a memorial. Mamboraka, Belila Kabo, Beliato, Fandiza Kaba, Redido Dalakade, Poruataku Dakata. There are some people, the moment it is 5 p.m. in the evening, they begin to hear songs. Sounds, different songs begin to play in their spirit. They are just, even if they are in the market, even if they are on the bike, the moment it is 5, a song begins to play in their heart. A song begins to play when you know you are no longer waiting for the song. When it is 5 o'clock, you leave everybody.
you go and stay in your closet and you begin to charge yourself and begin to see. After a while, Mahanaim will take place. Why is this so important? Because what God wants to achieve is not the result. What God wants to achieve is to make you. It's a making process. Every time God visits you, it's not about the activity. It's not even about the results that come out of it. You may start praying by 12 every day, and the prophetic will open to you. But it's beyond the prophetic. He wants to make you. He wants to make you. You may start praying every night, and you discover when you pray for the sick, they are naturally healed. It's beyond the healing anointing. He wants to make you somebody, because you were part of his kingdom before you departed. Those things he's doing, he's calling you back into the kingdom. There is a throne for you to occupy. There is a realm for you to walk. There is a dimension open and available to you. Those things were prepared for you before the foundation of the world. But sin and iniquity took you away. So everything God is doing is a wooing of the Spirit to bring you back to the place where you were. That's why in Genesis 1:26, he said, let us make man in our own image, after our likeness. It was always about the making process. He said, follow me, I will make you. The Bible says he called them to be with him before he will send them. It was always about making, because before you were born, maybe in your own tribe, God gave you the oracles of God. Like I said, the sons of Issachar, they have understanding of times and seasons and knew what Israel ought to do. But the son of Issachar can become a marketer. The son of Issachar can become a servant of iniquity. So when God began to summon him, it was not necessarily about the gift that would break out. It's about the throne the Issachars occupy in the spirit. He wants to make you. And one of the things God will make out of you is to make you a ruler. Sit down. Let me explain this and then we'll begin to pray. It's to make you a ruler. It's to make you a king in the spirit. Because in the kingdom of God, there are no servants. He's a king of kings. So even those of us serving, we are actually kings. He's a kingdom of kings. In Exodus 19 verse 4, he said, see how that by a mighty hand I delivered you from Egypt. He said, I have made you a kingdom of priests. I have made you. In 1 Peter 2 9, he said, you are a chosen generation, a royal priesthood, God's own special people, called forth to showcase the excellencies of God. In Revelation 1 6, he said, he has made you kings and priests unto the Lord. So what God wants to make of you is a ruler in the natural realm. And the reason you are a ruler is because you are in tune with it. There is a power that is waiting for you. If you don't tap into it, you cannot advance kingdom. Kingdom is not for faithful men alone. Kingdom is for rulers. Because it's a battle of thrones. There are many contentions to be faced. There are many powers that we try to negate what God is doing. So you don't only come there with a heart of service. You also come there with the authority to serve. And that authority to serve, that scepter, is when God makes you a king. So what the Holy Ghost has been wooing you to achieve is so that you can lay hold on your scepter in the spirit. And when you carry it, he said, where the word of the king is, there is power. Who can say unto him, what dwells thou? So when you come, you are not begging the world. You are not begging spirit. You become a commander. You become a commander. Then they tell you in your family, nobody graduates. You are not going to say, let's plan and donate money and send this one to school. You stand up in the morning and you say, in the name of the Lord Jesus, I break that spell that makes it impossible for men to graduate. And then people are wondering, what are you doing? You are reigning. You are reigning. That's what you are doing. Somebody comes to you and say, in our family we are barren. You say, oh, that's a devil. In the name of the Lord Jesus, I break barrenness. Go and have your children. And they say, wait, is that all? Yes, that is all. Because where the word of the king is, there is power. Who can say unto him, what doest thou? Somebody comes and looks at you and says, this thing will not work. You say, it will not work. Ah, you would have said this thing 10 years ago. Now, I don't know how to fail. You need to teach me how to fail, because everything I do works. Because if I'm working and it's not working, I will move back and I will look at it and tell it, in the name of Jesus, I command you, begin to walk. And because I've spoken, it will start working. That's why I told you in the morning, my children, they won't know how to. They won't know how to. Even if they wanted to, it's late. They already indicated it. Because we command the outcome. We don't beg it. When you see many people who have not known how these things work, they come to a place and they are begging God, Lord, please, in the name of Jesus, I entreat you, get this thing done. That's a new level of truth. It is the truth for the Christians in the Old Testament. If you want to function in the Old Testament, there's no argument. There's no argument. God bless you. Continue. But where we are now, we don't beg God to do this. That's why tithing in the New Testament is not for God to cast a devourer. The Old Testament believers was the devourers. So God needed to cast the devourers on them. So tithing was one of the things that invoked the power of God to cast the devourers. In the New Testament, we tithe because we are paying royalty to the king. When the devourer comes, we don't need to talk to God. I will look at the devourer and say, in the name of the Lord Jesus, I command you, get out, and the devourer will go. I'm not tithing because I want God to command the devourer. I rebuke the devourer. Me, I rebuke them. Because I'm a king. I'm a king. Do you now see why we dress well? Do you now see why you will never catch me sagging my jean trousers? No, it's wheelbarrow pushers that do that. It's those in the garage that do that. When kings come out, they know who they are. They don't only dress well. There is a way we walk. We don't walk haphazardly. We take our time because it's majesty. This is not pride. This is what he has made you to be. It's majesty. You walk like a king. You dress like a king. That's why I cannot expose my body. I'm a king. We reign. You can't find me. We don't talk anyhow. You run to him. Hey, we are finished. No, we don't talk like that. We are not finished. The reason is because we are the solution the world is looking for. We are not finished. If we are finished, the world is doomed. You are the light of the world. A city set upon a hill that cannot be hid. You come, you say, what is the problem? They say, hey, we don't know what to do. Calm down. He himself knows what to do. And we have the mind of Christ. Because we are co-heirs with Christ. We reign with Christ. We know what to do. You don't know what to do? Sit down. I will tell you what to do. And while you are sitting down, I turn back. Malo, brekida, kavak. La nosatali, paranda kida. La rondro fraklida, atavida, la tatali. What I'm trying to do, I'm entering the library of royals. I'm trying to check the secrets of the nobles. And then I come. I tell you, don't worry. In the name of the Lord Jesus, it's settled. When you leave me, do like this. Even if it was not ordained to happen like that, because we have said it, it will work. They come to you, they say you are sick. Sometimes they wake us up around 1 a.m. Hey, man of God, my mother has fainted. Calm down. You came to the solution, so calm down. Now, what is the problem? Calm down. It doesn't matter what the problem is. The one I'm working with, his name is called El Shaddai. It means he has more than enough. Your problem is not enough. Israel was in captivity for 400 years. As at the time he sent Moses, there were over 4 million people. And he didn't need to come himself. He sent Moses with his staff. If your captivity up to 40 years, are you 4 million? You are one. Your problem is not even up to 40 years. I'm talking about one that dealt with a problem of 400 years affecting 4 million people who didn't need to come himself. He sent somebody with a staff. And when Moses came, he said, stretch your staff to the Nile River. And the Nile River turns to blood. Moses wanted to part the Red Sea. He said, Lord, help us. He said, why do you turn to me? Go forward. Stretch your staff. You have everything you need. And when Moses stretched his staff, the Bible said, with a blast of his nostrils. Can you imagine? You want to part the Red Sea. Out of the many things you can do, you didn't do any of them. You now come and say,
And then you run. You say, hey, we are finished. No. That's why I say, let no one in Zion say I'm sick. Because Zion is a realm of kings. No one say I'm sick. We don't know how to say we are finished. We don't know how to say it's impossible. We say, how will it be done? Because it must be done. When you know this, four things happen. The first thing that happened to you is that you sustain a consciousness of a ruler. We don't beg. We are not arrogant. We are respectful. We honor all men, but we don't beg. When I'm walking with you, I'm doing it out of conviction, not because I'm hopeless. And if you assume for a second that I'm hopeless, because I'm doing it, not hopeless. I'm not. Because whatsoever I have to do, prosper. He has made us of hopeless. We came to change this world. And if I want to do it with you and you don't want to, no problem. Thank you. I still love and honor you, but there is another way to do it. Because kings are never out of ways. Do you not read about David? David went to a cave. That means it was a hopeless situation. But why David was in the cave? He wasn't crying. All the Psalms read, some of them were written in caves. All of them. He said, many are they that have risen up against me and said, there is no hope for me. They have cast me down and have condemned me. He said, but thou, O Lord, art a shield for me, my glory, and said, there is no hope for me. They have cast me down and have condemned me. He said, but thou, O Lord, art a shield for me, my glory. They have cast me down and have condemned me. He said, but thou, O Lord, art a shield for me. I utter that sentences. I proclaim parables. All trances that come from my spirit, they create my path. So I can come to a roadblock. I don't need to cry. All I need to do is to chart a new course. And then I stand up. I say, I can leap over it all. The God of heaven has gone ahead of me. And because the pillar of cloud has gone ahead, there is a way where there is no way. I look to the ends of the earth and I see my God standing. And I say, my Redeemer liveth. We don't know how to fail. We are kings. And kings know how to do two things. It's either they are ruling or they are reigning. When there is an opposition, you rule. But when there is no opposition, you reign. That's the good life. Some people make it look as if it's sin for you to live the good life. No, it's not. It's not. Poverty is not of God. No. You can suffer for the sake of the kingdom. But we don't know how to be poor. Happy. We don't know how to be poor. When things are not working, we make things work. We create the solution. Because that's who we are. We are kings. We bring solution when there is nothing to do. Because there is a consciousness of a ruler. Many young people can be confused in Zambia. I'm not one of them. Because I carry the consciousness, I will gather them together and say, this is what to do. This is the way to go. It will work. Don't be afraid, for the God of heaven, he is with us. Even if they call enchanters and necromancers to curse us, they can't curse us. We can't be cursed. We can't be cursed. They called Balaam. The Bible said, if Balaam curses you, you are cursed. If Balaam blesses you, you are blessed. Our life is not at the mercy of a man. We have become rulers. So if you like blessed, if you like cursed, whichever one you do, will still succeed. Because when Balaam was paid to curse them, he tried many times. And the point came, he said, there is no enchantment against Jacob. There is no divination against Israel. He said, the shout of the king is in their midst. The reason we are kings is because there is another king that reigns over us. You say you will fail exam. How can I fail biology when Zambia is waiting for me? How can I fail physics when the whole nation of Zambia is waiting for you? Physics is training ground. Biology is training ground. If I step into business today, I will prosper. I will not just go there hoping that things will work. When I come, I will carry all the books that talks about business. I will study the economy of Zambia. See, kings are not lazy. The nobles know the price to pay. because they don't know how to beg, they pay the price. The Bible said the Christians in Berea were more noble than those in Thessalonica, because when they heard Paul, they went to study to find out if the things he said were so. If I come into business, I'm not just praying in tongues and say, this business will work. I will study Zambia. What is the business at work? I will sit down and master how it works. Because when I come out, I need to give direction to people. So kings are not lazy. We pay the price to check how does this thing work. That's why sometimes, while men are sleeping, we are awake. Yes, we are awake. We read all night. There are times when we pray all night. If I want to see the president of this country, I don't need to do a special preparation. I studied by your nation before I came. We read all night because we are nobles. We don't lose direction. We give direction. When you see people idling away, they don't know who they are. They still want to go out there and beg. No, because you can't beg. You do your assignment. You are an economist. You are in the business world. You need to master all the laws. How does this business work? You need to know it. When you now know it, you now ascend beyond the laws. And then you begin to function by the elements of the spirit. You now predict the business beyond the laws. That's why when you become a king, your consciousness will provoke focus. Your consciousness will provoke diligence. Your consciousness will provoke hard work and smart work. Your consciousness will provoke every noble virtue that makes things work. No king is idle. If I tell you about the mighty men in this world, you'll be amazed the routine and the schedules they keep. You will hardly find a great man who sleeps for 6 hours in a day. You will hardly find him. Because he knows the destiny of others depend on him. If I go to the business world, I know I'm coming to save the economy. So I will not sleep when others are sleeping. You hardly find a great man sleeping more than 6 hours. 6 hours, my dying. I'm not learning how to die. Some people literally, they are sleeping. It's like death rehearsal. They are learning how to die. So they go to bed by 8. Oh, till 8 o'clock the next day. Every day sleep for 12 hours. Are you learning the way of the grave? Why men are sleeping, leaders are awake. There is a problem we must solve because they take responsibility. We are not going to blame the government of Zambia. We are coming to bring solution. So while others are sleeping, we are awake. It's the way of nobles. The way of nobles. It provokes a consciousness. Number two, it makes you pay the price to sustain the move of the spirit. Whatever it takes, if I need to fast for 40 days, every three months to keep it, I will. Because that's where my dominion mandate rests. That's why you see great men are always not everywhere. You will call them 20 times, they don't pick. It's not because they want to reject your call. They have a very serious business to do. Somebody calls you in the morning, 8 a.m. How far? What's happening? How is the family? Have you eaten? Where are you going to today? How does that have any value? How? When you call people, you are either interacting on how to create solutions or you are giving one. We don't hide away with folks. Where are you going to today? Which road are we going to be? What is that? A man who is about to change the world is wasting 15 minutes, 20 minutes talking nonsense. No. There is a move of the spirit and guiding against it. So there are things I don't see. No matter how people say it is, there is a demonic program in my country, they call it Big Brother Niger. They literally practice nudity in public. People sleeping themselves on the kitchen, but you see snails. That's what gives them joy. Because they are not on a mission to save the world. There is a move of the spirit in me that can die. Because I know my secret is that movement. So even if it's not a sin, so long as it begins to affect that movement, I cut it off. That's why we don't have any friends. Those of us that are keeping the move. That's why we have a very rigid schedule. Sometimes out of 168 hours in a week, you need to keep a schedule of 20 hours of talks to sustain that move. Sometimes you need to keep a schedule of 15 hours of study to sustain that move. Sometimes in 168 hours of the week, you will keep a schedule of at least 72 hours of fasting to sustain that move. Because there is something happening on your inside. It's another world. So you service that world by prayer. A normal person can pray for 30 minutes. It's okay. Not you. You are participating in another civilization. There is another world on your inside. It's bigger than the one others are seeing. So why the man who only lives in this world is praying for 15 minutes, 20 minutes? You may need to sustain 8 hours. You may need to pray for 10 hours. You are not asking God for bread and wine. No. There is a place you are contending for a place in that world. So that every time the Holy Ghost wants to breathe, he should breathe upon you. Anytime the Holy Ghost wants to stretch his hand, your hand is available. You have kept it on the shelf waiting for him. So if the Holy Ghost wants to heal, he will heal through you. If the Holy Ghost wants to sing, he will sing through you. If the Holy Ghost wants to shout, Shabbat, he will use your voice. Because you have paid the price to be relevant in that world. You have a place there. Every time the mighty are numbered, your place is there. You never miss out. You are always standing there. It's a price to pay to keep that move. It's a price. This is a Christianity that is not taught for our generation. Our generation is taught impartation. So they come, lay hands on. People should lay hands on them. They want to remove their bodies. They have a Bible in their home that they don't read. But they want to remove their apostles' bodies. And say, hey, they carry apostles' bodies. They have carried them. I know the Bible says handkerchiefs and apron were taken for the body of Paul. Those handkerchiefs were casting out demons and healing the sick. If you want to flow in grace, you will carry them. I know the Bible says handkerchiefs and apron were taken for the body of Paul. Those handkerchiefs were casting out demons and healing the sick. If you want to flow in grace, you will carry them. I know the Bible says handkerchiefs and apron were taken for the body of Paul. Those handkerchiefs were casting out demons and healing the sick. If you want to flow in grace, you will carry them. You are not important. Because world leaders don't read their speech. They flow from their spirit. So Barack Obama can stand up and talk for 2 hours. He won't consult anything. He's just flowing. He's flowing. Because he knows the problem. And he's prepared for today. World leaders don't read their speech. So you need to find out how leaders speak. You need to find out how leaders address. You need to find out the disposition of leaders. You need to know how to canvass. You need to know how to talk to people and get the people to believe you. So why the intercessor needs to pray 12 hours in a day? Because his job is in the altar. You, your own job is in the public. So you can pray for 4 hours. And you have other things to add. If you are a businessman, you need to study the patterns of the stock market. How does the stock market work? You need to take time to study. If you are a lawyer, you need to begin to read law reports. The most prominent lawyer, how... You will pay the money to buy his law report and you will read it because you want to be greater than him. It's not competition. His generation is ahead of you. You have a higher assignment. That's why we don't watch movies. Leaders don't watch movies. Because the movie is about them. I can't spend 2 hours watching somebody else who is making money. You are here to change the world. You are the one who is watching. And you can't be watching while they are watching you at the same time. So while they are watching you now, you are preparing the next one. It's the way of kings. The way of kings. The way of kings. You sustain the move of the Spirit. Number three, you constantly give instructions and follow up to ensure that they are done. Because kings are responsible. When things are going wrong, don't fold your hand. You can come to a church, things are disorganized. You came for the first time. Join them, find out what can I do. That's the way of kings, they take responsibilities. Dr. Paul told a story. How that he went into number two. Deeper life fellowship. Sometime around 1980s. When he entered the church, he came, they said service was 8 o'clock. He came around 7:40. No usher had come yet. Because those ones don't know the way of kingship. You need to pastor, need to call them and send them a message on Saturday to motivate them to come. And after service, they need to encourage them with good words and pamper them. Because they don't know they are fulfilling their own destiny. And when he came and he saw that no usher in the fellowship at that time was serious, he now stood at the door and began to welcome church. And they said, the first time I see this, but it's an usher. He's a king. He did it. Today, he's not ushering people to deeper life anymore. He's ushering people to the kingdom. It's not just talk. It's a life. It's a life. And finally, when you master how to give instruction and take responsibility, the final thing is that you sustain a nobility disposition. I can try 10 times. It doesn't mean I'm about to stop. The strongest warfare is the battle of attrition. When the devil wants to fight a great man, the primary objective is not to win him, it's to weary him out. So they are just fighting, they are waiting for a weakening. That's the battle of attrition. Aaron can stand up today and say, okay, let them go. Tomorrow you say no. So you will sustain a no-quitting disposition. There is a cancer growing in my body. You must die. You must die. There is no day I wake up and say, God, this thing is like it will not work. In the name of Jesus, I command this growth to be uprooted. I command you to die. 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 When the cancer sees that you are not giving up, it will back out. It will back out. I start the business, it's not working. You will see something. I will do it 100 times. See, many times when I start something, I tell myself, the gauge where we start from is 100 after 100 times. So failure is a good opportunity to learn. When I fail, I thank God, I want another means. Another way I do not work. So I will keep it in my archive. It will equip me as a teacher. So when I'm teaching now, I know what to tell people. I know where to tell people to avoid. So I'm never discouraged by failure. In fact, failure gives me more experience. I'm not preparing to fail, but I'm also not giving up because of failure. A king doesn't know how to give. The reason is because he's fighting for others. We will pray for the sick this night. We are not going to pray for the sick and say you are healed, and then we say, thank God. No, we will call you out. So that if you are not yet healed, we will be here again for you. And then we need to mobilize 5 people, and we will keep praying. We will pray until the cancer goes. We are not praying and then, because camera is recording. If it does happen, that case so that people don't know that it will work. If you go behind the camera, you will never succeed. If I give you a word of knowledge, where are you going? If the person is not there, that means I've learned one way not to operate. There is nothing like shame with a king. Because they go that it must work. So the person says there is pain, we pray, we say, yes. You know, nowadays, these Christians say, to encourage you, it has reduced. Don't help my ministry. Because you respect me, I will pray for somebody else who doesn't respect me. So if you think you are expecting me when the growth is there or the pain is there, and you say it has reduced, you didn't help me, you don't respect me. Because the next person I'm going to pray for is how to tell me you are fake. So I need you to tell me when you lay hands on the sick, they will recover. So if I lay hands on, cast out devils, you shall speak with new tongue. So when I cast the demon out and he says it's not going, I will just look at you. Do you know what you are saying? You know, in the morning, we were casting out an epileptic spirit from a lady here. I said, get up! And the lady looked at me and did like, oh! And she did like, if you like, become a tigress. I will stand where I am.
When I looked at the demon, checked me well. You know, I discovered this one is not joking. If I don't go, we will remain here. It's not this one. You start casting out demon, and when you see that the demon is stubborn, then I say, okay, take them to the back, intercessors, interwalk. Do you not know that casting out demons is a display of two kingdoms? We don't cast demons in the hiding. We cast them out in the public. Because having spoiled principalities and powers, he made a public show of them, triumphing over them in victory. We don't cast out demons behind. We cast them up where everybody will see. Because it's a testimony that Jesus reigned. He reigns forever. See, it's not a testimony to stay with the demon for 1 hour. But if I have to stay for 1 hour, I will stay. You must go today. You must go today. Mako Maka. Sometimes I'm casting out the demon, and the demon is proving to be stubborn. And I check my spirit. All the resources I have is not enough. I will step to the back and charge myself. I wear another garment and I come again. The first garment I wore was a garment of knowledge. Since you don't respect knowledge, I went back and wore the garment of fire. And it maketh his angels spirits, but his ministers flames of fire. If I show up now, it's no longer knowledge. Maruata, Vegode, Bakura, Dagata, Dekado, Vakatiga, Sesezane, Maridadada, Barakakoga, Edadona, Maruata Teta, Inadope, Kator, in the name, the demon will start running. Happy. Kings don't back down. Do you know one of the codes of the nobles? One of the codes of the nobles is to die honorably. For a king to run in shame, he will stand and say, kill me. We don't back down. That's why when Saul, even though he was now turned away from God, he still knew he was noble. He said, no, my enemies can kill me. And we don't run from battle. He said, fall upon me. I'd rather keep my nobility than to run like a coward. That's why nobles, in the days of old, during the era of the kingdom, if you challenge a man, he doesn't know how to say no. He will fight. And instead of leaving that ring in shame, he will rather die there. We don't back down. There is no running back with kings. We don't draw back onto petition. We forward, we push until we get it done. And tonight, somebody's crisis is about to leave by the power of the Holy Spirit. The night of saying enough is enough is here. This cancer, you will go tonight. It's not whether you give me or I give you, you will die. This growth, you will die tonight. This pain, you will die. This reproach, you will go back tonight. Because we are ready. We will begin to pray. After a while, please remove his hand from his back so he doesn't enjoy himself. After a while, if the praying we are praying is not enough, we will summon fire. If the fire is not enough, we will summon thunder. If thunder is not enough, we will summon cherubims. But the shift must happen, and it must happen now. He said, weeping may endure for the night, but joy comes in the morning. Our light affliction are but for a moment. They work for us an eternal weight of glory. That reproach that say I won't get married, it ends now. Now. That thing that say my ministry will not be known, my voice will not be heard, it will go down now. Maro vakata, elika pateke, vevevala katoa. You want to ascend in the spirit? I
and begin to give commandments. Marakoata, Elodea, Veber, Shada, Babuaketa, Mantoka Batae, Beriato Takabana.